But I want to talk to you guys today about the glory of the Lord. What is the glory of the Lord? And if you know me, I'm not into the fake stuff. I want reality. I want what's real. You know, I'm not into the gold dust. I'm not into, gold teeth. I'm into what's real. That's what I'm into. I'm into what's real. So, with that being said, I want to talk to you guys today about the glory of God, which is Yahweh, and His Son, Jesus, Yeshua. Okay? The scripture in Romans chapter 11, verse 33, it says, "Oh, the depths of the riches, both of wisdom and knowledge of Yahweh, of God. How unsearchable are His judgments and His ways past finding out." And what that simply means is, Paul here is talking about how awesome God is in His plans for salvation. That's the context of what he's talking about in Romans chapter 11, verse 33. He was talking about the mysteries of what was being concealed, what was hidden. So in Romans chapter 11, verse 33, Paul, begins to talk about, the depths and riches both of wisdom and knowledge of Yahweh, how unsearchable His judgments and His ways past finding out. Man, he's talking about salvation coming to the Jews and the Gentiles, which, has been hidden for the ages, but this mystery is now coming forth. All right? And I remember a scripture that I was given, was given to me when I was young. This scripture was given to me in 1987. You guys ready? It was given to me in 1987. It's Ephesians chapter 3. I want to read it to you. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. But before I get to that one, I want to read the one right before. It's Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17. And it says this. And I'm just working into what I'm going to be talking to you guys about. Believe me, it is going to get really good. I'm going to open up some good stuff. But this was a scripture that was given to me back in 1987. I was 17 years old, raised in a church my whole life, but never understood the Lord like I understand Him now. Knew all about Him, but didn't know Him, if I could say that. And in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17, Paul says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, chapter 1, 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. Amen. Go ahead.
Hallelujah. Oh, next one?
Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
Verse 18.
Yeah, I know.
In the revelation of the knowledge of Him, that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of His calling and what is the riches of His glory. What is the riches of His glory? And I'm going to get into glory, what that is. Of His inheritance in the saints. And what is the exceeding greatness of His power to usward who believe according to the working of His mighty power, which He wrought in Christ when He raised Him from the dead and set Him at His own right hand in heavenly places. And if you go to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. Ephesians chapter 3. I got written inside of my Bible. This is, I got wrote here from 1987 in this Bible. It says, a lady in church, Sister Penny Oriole, come up to me when I was 17 years old, and she said, "The Lord wanted me to give you this word. He had a word for you." And in verse 16, it says that He would grant you according to the riches of His glory. The riches of glory. What is the riches of glory? We're going to find out what that is. To be strengthened with His might by His Spirit in your inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love, may be able, and this is the verse, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, what is the length, what is the depth and height. Man, that is really, you know, getting in to knowing. I'm going to read a couple other verses. But, you know, to really get into knowing how unsearchable are the ways of the Lord. How deep do you really want to go? Do you want to stay on a surface? Do you want to be fed milk your whole life? Or do you really want to have a grasp on, you know, who God is and what He's about and what He has to offer us? You know, it's more than what's on the surface. So if you want to find out what the glory of God is, well, you have to start looking for Him. Amen. You have to start digging. Because if you want anything that's good, you have to dig for it. Gold, silver, precious stones, emeralds, diamonds, sapphires, they're not sitting on the top of the ground. They're not sitting on the top of the ground. So if you, there's some people that you talk to, you know, like, this just happened to me recently. You know, they like, man, I don't even know why you go back into the old covenant. I'm not, this is a guy just told me this. I heard from another person that I'm not going over there. I mean, he's going to start talking about stuff in the old covenant. And, you know, look, you know, I'm all about, you know, the gospel. You know, that's what he says. And about Jesus died and rose again. Well, that's what the whole Bible, all 66 books of the Bible is about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what it's all about. And if you want to go deeper, well, then you have to dig deeper. And when you begin to dig, that's when you begin to see and realize and grab a hold of the glory of God. Now, the Bible says that the heavens declare His glories. We know that the constellations that are up there, it's even talking about Job, you know, Orion and all of this stuff. The heavens declare the glory of God. In fact, the gospel is written in the heavens. And if we look around us, the Bible says that God gives us the natural things of this earth, so that we can understand the things of the Spirit, so that those that when they come and appear before the Lord in the end times, they're without excuse. So God gives us, if we was a mile further away from, you know, the sun, we would, you know, be frozen planet. If we was a mile closer, or they said a few hundred feet, we would burn up. So, I mean, the trees give off oxygen, and that's how we receive our life, and we give off, you know, carbon monoxide, and that's what they need. And this big ecosystem that God developed, I mean, works perfectly in His design. And like I said at that meeting over there, if you believe that all the species known to mankind that's in the world today, if you believe in, you know, Darwinism, or that, you know, we evolved, I mean, you got to be a lunatic. Right. It'll take more faith to believe that a male elephant and a female elephant crawled out the goo and was able to reproduce and make a little one, or one male spider and a female spider crawled out the goo, and then we got to go through a million species that they all crawled out of the goo, both male and female, and was able to produce. Now give me a break. If there's a creation, there's a creator. Amen. And what we're going to do today is we're going to go look and, you know, we're going to see the glory of God. Let's really get into it. So anyway, but this scripture right here that Sister Penny had given to me, a woman who really loves the Lord, her and Brother Frank. Brother Frank imparted into me when I was young, and I love them both. But anyway, and in verse 18 it says that you may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height. I remember that when the Lord started revealing Himself to me, I mean, man, it changed my life. And the stuff that the Lord revealed to me is what I reveal now, and that's the fire. It's the passion. It's, you know, it's, you see me, you know, I get crazy. I'll get up on a chair and like, because it is so absolutely like, that's the glory. Yeah. It's not me standing on a chair. The glory of the revelation of what He done.
Yeah.
I mean, how could every story in the old covenant be hidden, something hidden in there? It's all about Jesus. I mean, down to the names. Yeah. And I mean, How can an altar that Joshua put in the Jordan, 1,500 years before Jesus Christ came, he built an altar of 12 stones in the Jordan. And here it is. God made an altar in the Jordan 1,500 years later. Why was it in Bethel Berea? Why does it say in John chapter 1, verse 28 that John is baptizing in that same place and Jesus comes to John? Because that altar was built for him 1,500 years before he even came. Come on. Jesus comes in the Jordan. He's in the water. Now he's standing on an altar. Now you got the altar in the laver, the altar in the water, and he's standing on 12 stones, right? Yeah. And that's where God baptized him. That's why I get crazy. That's why I get pumped up. Because you got to go under the water. You got to go down deep. Can you imagine that altar that was out there when Jesus walked up? I guarantee you, John's standing there, then he stands up on 12 stones. It was put there for a reason. 1,500 years. But if you don't start looking for him and searching, that's the glory of God. He is so amazing, so powerful, so wonderful, so out there, that when you begin to see things like that, even talking about cutting off the ear and all of this, and the last miracle that Jesus did is restoring the hearing. And when you catch what that is, oh my God, and you hear Jesus preach about now, those who have ears, let them hear. Why? Because the ear was severed in the garden. Hearing was lost. And he was there to restore the hearing back unto man. Come on.
Hallelujah.
That's fire.
Amen.
That's reality.
Reality.
That's the glory of God that was hidden in a mystery now being revealed.
Hallelujah.
And we see it in the face of Jesus Christ, because when he comes, he fulfills it all. Watch. So, we're gonna go back into the old covenant. We started in the new covenant. The old covenant is just an old covenant. It ain't an Old Testament. The testament is still alive and speaks of Jesus Christ today. I don't care how you cut it, slice it, dice it. When you open it up, it's Jesus. It's Jesus. It's Jesus. And you got people that say, I don't want none of that. Well, I want it all.
Yeah.
I want it all.
Amen.
So let's look. The first time, and I'm going to bring you into the, let's go to Exodus chapter 16. Exodus chapter 16. We're going to go all the way to the first time we actually see the glory of the Lord. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 10, we're going to read there. Exodus 16, verse 10. Exodus 16, verse 10, it says, and it came to pass, as Aaron spake unto the whole congregation of the children of Israel, that they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in a cloud. So, we think about, there's a lot of things, show us your glory. We sing these songs. We're thinking, what is the glory? What are we actually asking? Well, his glory has been revealed in the face of Jesus Christ. If you want to see the glory, all you have to do is go back to the word. But what we're really, we're singing these songs, show us your glory. We want to see a mist or a vapor, or we want to see gold dust, or we want to see all of these things, But the glory of the Lord is revealed in his word. You understand that?
Yes.
And if you are looking for other things to show forth the glory, you can be led astray. Oh, look, brother, I got the glory of the Lord. It's in my tooth. Well, am I saying that God can't do that? No. He can do what he wants. But if you want to see the glory of God, the only place you're going to see it is in the face of Jesus Christ. Because that's what the Bible says. Right? The Bible says you're going to see all kind of false signs in the end. Yeah. A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh for a sign, right? Yeah. But no sign shall be given, but the sign of Jonah. As Jonah, whose name means dove, was in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights. So now going from Jonah, it's likening unto Jesus. He's making the connection to Jesus. You're going to see the glory. The Son of Man is going to be buried for 3 days and three nights and be raised again.
Amen.
That's the glory of God.
Amen.
It's in the face of Jesus. Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So if you want to see the glory of God, if you want to see the face of God, if you want to see the power of God, if you want to see God, you have to find Jesus.
Yeah.
You have to find Jesus. So that's what my life is about. Looking for Jesus.
Yeah.
Let's look for Him. And I'm going to show you the glory of God. The true glory of God.
Yeah.
Right? And then the glory is manifested, which we're going to get into in a lot of ways. But the face of it is Jesus Christ. So in Exodus chapter 16, we see the first time glory is mentioned in the Bible. In Exodus chapter 16, we see the glory. It says, and it came to pass, as Aaron spake unto the whole congregation of the children of Israel, that they looked toward the wilderness, and behold, the glory of the Lord appeared in a cloud. So the glory of the Lord appeared. This is Exodus. The children of Israel leave Egypt. Egypt was the altar. Remember, the blood was shed there in Egypt. They went straight to the Red Sea. That's the laver, the altar in the water. Here's the picture again. Remember, Jesus in the Jordan, the altar in the water. They go there. They're hungry. They start complaining. So God preserves them in hunger right here. The glory of the Lord appeared in a cloud. Jesus returns in the cloud. So the glory comes in the cloud, which is crazy, because the cloud, if you look it up in the Bible, cloud represents witnesses. And that's what we are. We are so great a cloud of witnesses. Now, it has other meanings, but when we begin to rehearse what God has done, we're showing forth His glory. We're showing forth the glory of God through His Word by His Son. So now, go the second time we see it. Now let's go to Exodus chapter 24, verse 1 through 18. And I want to read it because everything I read to you guys, I'm going to show you Jesus Christ. We want to see Jesus. Show us your glory. So we're going to go to Exodus chapter, and I'm going to start reading. Exodus chapter 24, verse 1 through 18. And we're going to look for Jesus right here. And he said unto Moses, come up to, and this is God calling Moses up. The covenant now is going to be ratified through blood. And in chapter 24, verse 1, it says here, and I like to stay in context so you know what's happening and what's going on. And he says, and he said unto Moses, come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Jesus. Well, I just found Jesus already. Jesus, right? Remember, he chose 70 disciples. Wow. Right, remember? Moses was drawn out. Jesus, you know, Moses had 12, the 12 tribes of Israel. I mean, Jesus chose 12 disciples. Moses had the 70 elders. Jesus had, in Luke 10, the 70 other disciples that he sent out. Remember? There's a connection. He's going to only do, Jesus said, I only do what I see my Father do. I see my Father take 12 tribes. I'm going to take 12 disciples. I see my Father take 70 elders. I'm going to get me 70 other disciples and send them out. I'm only going to do what I see my Father do. That in that way, we could see the glory of God manifested
Amen.
In the earth.
Amen.
So let's go. He says, and Moses alone shall come near to the Lord, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him. That's verse 2, verse 3. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord. That word Lord there, King James broke it into Lord, but it's the word actually Yahweh. So, because Lord means landowner, and Lord translates back to Bel or Baal. Okay? But in the King James, if you go to the front, you'll find out that everywhere you see capital L-O-R-D, it's Yahweh. Y-H-W-H. Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh. Yahweh. Y-H-W-E-H. And Moses came and told the people the words of the Lord, and the judgments, and all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord hath said, we will do. That was the covenant that was being ratified. God was marrying the children of Israel at the mount, and they said, I do. We will do. That's what was going on right there, right? And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord and rose up early in the morning and built an altar under the hill. That's under the hill is the word. It's actually a hoopah. The mountain is a hoopah. They came under the hoopah of the mountain or under the hill, and that's why you get married under a banner. Right? That's a hoopah, okay? That's what's happening here. So when you understand that this old covenant is a wedding ceremony, a wedding proposal, for God said in Jeremiah, for I married you at that. I betrothed you as a wife there. You become, you know, my bride there. Right? Let's keep going. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord, in verse 5. And he sent young men of the children of Israel, and they went and offered burnt offerings and sacrifice and peace offerings and oxen unto the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in the basins, and the other half the blood he sprinkled it on the altar. And he took the book of the covenant, a covenant. That's what you do when you get married. You're making a marriage covenant, right? And he read it in the audience of the people. Now he's reading it, and they said, all the Lord had said we will do. So Moses read the five books, the Torah, to them. That's what he read, the Torah. And Torah means direction, instruction, and guidance. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people. Wow. On the blood's got to go on the people for the covenant to come into existence. That's why the only way you could come into covenant with Jesus Christ is by his blood coming through the door. Right? Okay. And he said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders, and they saw the God of Israel. And watch this. And there under his feet, as it was a paved work of sapphire stone, and as it were the body of heaven in its clearness. Man, they're getting a vision. They're seeing something, right? The glory of God. They're seeing it now for the second time in the Bible. And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. Also, they saw God and did eat and drink. And the Lord said unto Moses, come up to me in the mount and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone and a law. That word law is Torah. That means direction, instruction, and guidance. And the commandments which I have written that thou mayest teach them. And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua. Wow. And his minister Joshua. And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua. Joshua's name means Yeshua, which means Jesus. Look who's closely associated with Moses. And Moses went up into the mount of God. Go to the next one. And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us. He told the elders that until we, who? Moses and Joshua, come again unto you. Why? Because Joshua has a big part in this. Because he means something. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. So Aaron and Hur stayed. And if any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. Go to the next one. And Moses went up into the mount, and the cloud covered the mount. Go ahead. And the glory of the Lord abode upon the mount, on Mount Sinai. And the cloud covered it 6 days. Wow, check this out. The cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And the sight of the glory of the Lord was like devouring fire. Wow. On the top of the mount in the eyes of the children of Israel. Now watch this. He says, why does he wait 6 days and then call him up on the seventh? Because after 6,000 years, on the seventh, which is the millennial reign, we're going to get called up, right? You're with me now. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount. And Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. That's why Jesus fasted 40 days and 40 nights. He's a picture of Moses. Moses' name means to be drawn out. And that's who Jesus was. Jesus was drawn out of the dry ground. He was a root of David, drawn out of the dry ground. Are you with me?
Yes.
You're with me?
Yes.
Moses is a picture, for Moses said, for I shall be as a God unto the people, right? And Joshua is going to be, you know, the servant. That's what he said. Moses and Joshua, right? Now watch. Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights. Do you see Jesus? Come on, go to the next one. What? This is amazing stuff. Go to the next one.
25.
Yeah, go to 25. Is it?
Yeah.
Right, right, 25. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, hold on. Speak unto the children of Israel that they bring me an offering of every man that giveth it willingly with his heart. Ye shall take my offering willingly. And this is the offering which you shall take of them, gold and silver and brass, and blue and purple and scarlet and fine twined linen and goat's hair, and ram skins dyed red. Wow. And badger skins. That word badger is seal skin. Seal skin was they used so it would be waterproof. Oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil, and for a sweet incense. Onyx stones and stones to be set in the ephod and in the breastplate. And let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. So God wants a sanctuary that he could dwell in, according to all that I've shown thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of the instruments thereof, even so shall ye make it. And they shall make an ark of shittim wood. That word shittim is acacia. It means it doesn't see corruption. That's why Jesus was raised out of the dead, you know, raised from the dead, you know, on the third day, because 4 days you see corruption. But God is still able to raise up the corrupted ones, because we know that Lazarus was in the grave 4 days and he rose him up. Remember? He says, 2 cubits and a half shall ye make the length of it, 1.5 cubits the breadth thereof, and 1.5 cubits the height thereof. And thou shalt overlay it with pure gold within and without. The purity speaks of Christ. Thou shalt overlay it, and thou shalt make it on top of it a crown round about it, because he's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He sits on, you know, the mercy seat. And thou shalt cast 4 rings of gold for it. The 4 rings represent the 4 gospels, and thou shalt put in them 4 corners. That's what everything is built on. The foundation of the gospel of Jesus Christ is built on the 4 gospels, and 4 is the door. It's how God set everything up. 4 corners thereof, and 2 rings shall be in one side, and 2 rings on the other side. And thou shalt make staves of shittim wood, and overlay them with gold. And thou shalt put staves into the rings by the sides of the ark, that the ark may be borne with them. Now hold on a second. What verse is that? 25:15. 25:20. I'm gonna keep reading. Okay, I'm getting to where I wanted to go. Okay, the staff shall be in the rings of the ark. They got to bear it on their shoulders. They shall not be taken from it. Thou shalt, and the reason the staffs wasn't taken from the ark, because the ark was in transit in the wilderness for 40 years. The staffs was not taken out until it went into Solomon's temple, and then it was removed. Okay, because now God had a physical house. He was in transition from Egypt to where, you know, Solomon ultimately built the temple of God. And there, well, actually, when it came over with Joshua, it went to Shiloh first, and then from Shiloh, David took it up into the tabernacle and built the tent tabernacle. And then David had the instructions, and then Solomon through Hiram built the temple, and then the staves were removed. And then from there, in 586, the ark disappeared. And thou shalt put into the ark the testimony, put into the ark the testimony which I shall give thee. The ark represents Jesus Christ as a body, and the testimony of who God was in the Son. And thou shalt make a mercy seat of pure gold, 2.5 cubits shall be the length thereof, and 1.5 cubits the breadth thereof. And thou shalt make 2 cherubim of gold of beaten work, thou shalt make them in the 2 ends of the mercy seat. And make 1 cherubim on the end. Hold on a second, Lord. 25:19. 24. Make sure I'm reading. Okay, let me just stop there. I don't want to get into all of that. Oh, okay, now go to chapter 33, verse 8. Chapter 33, verse 8.
Exodus.
Yeah, Exodus 33, verse 8. I was supposed to stop way early in this, but it's all good. I like to see Jesus, you know. I like to see, that's because, listen, when you read the Word of God, look for Jesus. That's what you need to do. Look for Him. That's what we're doing, looking for Him. Exodus 33. You got it? Exodus chapter 33. If you don't got it, I'm going to start reading. Okay, Exodus chapter 33. And it came to pass, when Moses went out unto the tabernacle, that all the people rose up and stood every man in his tent door, and looked after Moses until he was gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass, as Moses entered into the tabernacle, that the cloudy pillar descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle, and the Lord talked with Moses. So from the tabernacle, God spoke to Moses. Just like in the garden, God spoke to Adam until Adam sinned and he was put out. And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the tabernacle door, and all the people rose up and worshiped every man at his tent door. And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face. That word face to face is the showbread table. They called it it the face bread. The face bread. That's what they put, the 12 loaves on the showbread table. It's called the bread of face. It's when you come into intimacy with Jesus Christ and he begins to speak to you face to face from his word. This is it right here. Look, here it is. Face, this is the only way you can get face to face with Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Here it is right here. You face to face with him.
Yes.
And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face as a man speaketh unto his friend. And he turned again into the camp, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. Why? Why? Because the tabernacle represents Jesus Christ. Yeshua, Joshua, Yeshua. It's the same word. That's why you see him. Joshua stayed in the tabernacle because the tabernacle is Joshua. It is Yeshua that's coming. That is a foreshadow of the glory of God that's going to be manifested in the face of Yeshua. And in Hebrews, he's actually called Joshua. Right. He says, and Moses said unto the Lord, see, thou sayest unto me, bring up this people, and thou hast not let me know whom thou wilt send with me. Wow, we're going to send with him. Yet thou hast said, I know thee by name, and thou hast also found grace in my sight. Wow, who are you going to send with Moses? Joshua. How do you find grace? Through Christ. Right? Now therefore I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I may know thee. That's what it's about, to know him, that I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people. And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest. Our rest is through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And he said unto him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up hence. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? Moses, the law, looking for grace.
Grace.
Wow. Is it not in that thou goest with us? So that's what Jesus said. You know, he's with us wherever we go.
Amen.
He's with us wherever we go. So shall we be separated, I and thy people. Wait, let me go back and read. For wherein shall it be known here that I and thy people have found grace in thy sight? Question mark. Is it not in that thou goest with us? So shall we be separated, I and thy people, from all the people. These are separated. That word separated right there is ecclesia, called out church.
Amen.
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 Called out from amongst the people to be separated unto holiness unto him.
Amen.
That's what we've been called to do.
Yes.
Amen.
I and thy people, from all the people that are upon the face of the earth. Here it is, going to the Gentiles. All the people.
Oh.
Not only them, not only Israel. But you and me, salvation hidden in the mystery.
Yes.
Paul said, sealed up until now. Go ahead. Next verse. We'll get to verse 18. And he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. Show me thy glory. Moses is wanting to see the glory of God. The glory of God is Jesus Christ. You see, it's all hidden. It's all concealed. But he knows something is going on. And God says, build me a tabernacle. Do this. Make me a lampstand. Make me a showbread table. Make me an altar of incense. Make me a dwelling place, a tabernacle that I can come and dwell within the midst of the people. And that was in the face of Jesus Christ, the dwelling place of God, in a skinu, a skin tent. Watch this. Here is one of the first places that we actually get to see his glory manifested. Manifest. And this comes from Charlene, that the teaching that she had just given us this Wednesday. Man, the Lord has revealed some things to me that, I mean, he just punched me with, because the scripture that God had given me when I started out was Proverbs 25:2. It is the glory of God to conceal a matter. It's His glory to do it.
That's right.
He likes to do it.
Yes.
But it's the honor of kings. The Bible says that we're all kings. A royal priesthood.
Yes.
Right?
Kings and priests. Yes.
He said, it's my glory to conceal something from you so that you will go look for me.
That's right.
Amen.
So when you find me, son, let me show you what I found. I found 12 stones in a Jordan and Jesus standing on them.
Yeah.
I saw Elisha, whose name means Jesus, throw a stick, a dead stick, into the water where the axe head flew off. John says that Jesus was the axe head, and that axe head sunk down in a Jordan on an altar. He threw that dead stick up and it rose again.
Wow.
I found Jesus.
Yes.
He is the axe head.
Yes.
Mm.
Amen.
I know what the glory looks like.
Amen.
And I'm sorry to say, it wasn't a mist above my head. It was when I got face to face with Him.
Amen.
He showed me His glory. Man.
I deserve a shout.
Yeah.
Ain't nothing holding you back. Ain't nothing holding you back. I'm just showing you His glory.
Yes. Amen.
His glory was manifested. Now, manifest, Charlene, thank you for your time you put into this. Manifest, both in the Hebrew and the Greek, means to make clear or to make plain. So my job, when I found His glory, I'm here to make it clear and plain to you how I found His glory.
Yes.
In the river, in the Jordan, the 12 stones, the altar in Egypt, the Red Sea, you know, the severing of the ear, the taking of Simeon. He took Simeon. Simeon means hearing. When you bring me back Benjamin, Benjamin named is the son of the right hand, then I'll restore Simeon back to you. I'll give you back your hearing when you bring me the son of the right hand. That's what Joseph said. That's what he said. What was in the sack? What was in Benjamin's sack? Remember? There was three things in Benjamin's sack. Benjamin's name means the son of the right hand. He was the last born. Jesus said, I am the first and the last. There were 12 tribes. Remember, the firstborn was Reuben. Behold the son. Jesus said, I'm the first and the last. The firstborn was Reuben. The lastborn was Benjamin. Reuben's name means behold the son, the lastborn. The son of the right hand. What was in the mouth of Benjamin's sack? Money, food, provision. And a silver cup. Silver is redemption. Was in the mouth of the son of the right hand. Ah! Tell me where you heard that before. Only when you come face to face with Him does He reveal Himself to you. That's why I'll never be the same.
Amen.
Never. Because He is just that awesome. And when He shows Himself to you, oh my God, it's life changing.
Yeah. Amen.
It ain't no longer you heard.
That's right.
Tell me about His glory.
Amen.
Tell me about His glory. Hey man, come on into the tent. Come on in. You don't have to stand outside by the altar in the laver. Yeah, that's a picture of His death, burial, and resurrection, the altar and the laver. Water, remember? Water is a repent and be baptized for the remission of sins, and this you're doing, taking part in the death, burial, and resurrection. Unless a man is born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. Man, when you do that, you get to enter in through the door, man. Come into the way the light is. The light and the illumination of the Holy Spirit shining on the showbread table. You come in face to face with Him. He begins intimacy with you. He begins to reveal Himself to you and smash down at the altar of incense, because all you're doing is, my God, how awesome you are. That's That is true worship.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
True worship can only come when you've been in the presence of the Father.
Yeah.
True worship ain't in here singing songs.
Right.
True worship is down on your face when He reveals something to you that's so absolutely mind-blowing. All you could do is worship.
That's right. That's right.
You got it.
Been there, done that.
Yeah.
Want some more of it.
Yeah.
And not happy until I get some more.
Yeah. Amen.
Come and feast at the Master's table. So, His manifested glory. You want to see His glory manifested both in the Hebrew and the Greek? It needs to make clear and plain. Do you really honestly want Jesus?
Yes.
So, to manifest, we want to see His glory manifested. That's what we want. So, to manifest His glory both in the Hebrew and the Greek, it means to make clear and plain. That's what God has revealed to me. To make clear and plain His word. It's not complicated.
Yes.
He loves us. If you want to know all about God, all you have to do is look at Jesus.
Yes.
That's it. Some people think God's up there with a big, you know, board wanting to beat you. And all He's wanting to do is love you.
Yes.
Full of mercy and grace. That's how He's described. There is an opposite side. He has a hand. And He'll put it on your behind if you get out of line.
Yeah.
I've been out of line before and He put it on my behind.
Yeah.
You heard me.
Yeah.
I'm a person like you. That's it. Never finished, didn't graduate high school, didn't go to the seminary. I just got in His presence.
Amen.
Neither was I taught by man, Paul said, but by the Spirit, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the truth.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
And I guarantee you, me spitting on you ain't the glory. You don't want to get spit on. But yet He'll take that spit and make some new eyeballs out of clay.
Amen.
That's His spit, not mine. Thank you, Cherie. Let's look. So, to manifest His glory, Jesus, that's what He did. So, to manifest means to display. To put it on display. That's what we did this week. We set the tabernacle up.
Yes.
We put Him on display.
Ooh, hallelujah.
You can't get into the wedding feast unless you come through that.
Right.
And that you come through is Him.
Yes.
It is Him. A lot of people didn't even know. I hope, you know, some received. Some didn't. Some thought it was dumb. Because they don't have ears to hear.
Right.
It means to display or to reveal.
Amen.
That's what we were trying to do. To explain Him. To make visible to the eye. How is this Jesus? Man, you see this altar? Well, He died. This altar is in representation of a cross. You see it's brass? The Bible says brass is suffering. He had to suffer. You see why it's outside of the gate? Jesus died outside of the gate.
Amen.
You see outside the gate, the blood and the water? That's why outside these doors is the altar and the laver. And the only way you could come into Him to be His bride is through His side. Yeah. That's how Adam had to be laid down for his bride to come forth. So Jesus had to be laid down for us to come forth. Man, I'm showing you glory.
Yeah.
Amen.
And it ain't in the vapor.
Yes.
And it ain't in the spit.
Amen.
And it ain't in the gold dust.
Amen.
It's in His word.
Yes, it is.
Great. In His word, by His word, through His word,
yes.
Only.
Woo.
To make understand. Do you understand what I'm telling you?
Yes.
Right, you understand.
Praise God.
To appear. Yes. Man, you can see Him now. To show plainly, to disclose or to display, I mean to open it up. Paul said the mystery that's been hidden from the ages was that the Gentiles was going to be engrafted in. So He disclosed the mystery that has been hidden. And that's why He said, how unsearchable are the depths and the width and the height of You, O Lord. Only You could do something like this. It hadn't even crossed the imagination of a man to do something like this.
Amen.
Wow! Could anybody in here ever think about that plan? No. You want to save yourself. But God loves us all.
Yes,
it means to exhibit. We set the tabernacle up.
Yeah.
Put it on exhibit. To disclose what has been hidden in secret. To explain what has been obscure. Man, I got people telling me I'm crazy because I read the old covenant. Man, I don't read that. We're in a new covenant now. My God. Yeah, we're in a new covenant. But the old covenant was a new covenant. It just wasn't manifested yet. The old speaks of the new.
Yes.
It's concealed in the old, revealed in the new.
Yeah.
Amen.
God the Father is of the old. Yeshua is of the new. You can't have one without having the other.
That's right. Amen.
And all Jesus come to do was reveal his Father. And all his Father is doing is talking about him.
That's right.
My God, son.
Amen.
To make it evident, is it not evident tonight, today, that Jesus is our rest?
Yes.
If you found him, you found everything. You found the most precious stone in the world.
Yes.
It don't matter where you've been, what you've done.
Thank you, Lord.
It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. He uses the worst of the worst. That's why he used me. And puts us on display. I can't even tell you how many adulterous affairs I had on my wife. More than I can count on my hands and yours put together. And your wife's. Yeah. Yes. And God would take me and change me. But he showed me who he was. And now for me to be unfaithful, I have to be unfaithful to him.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna happen.
Because
you have to have it here before you can have it here. And if you got it here, well then I'm in the covenant. I am committed, steadfast, staying. I don't care what we go through in our marriage.
Yeah.
I am here for the long haul till death do us part.
Amen.
Now I understand. You see, before I didn't understand the covenant. I didn't understand it. But he came in covenant with me and showed me what his covenant was. And then I said, I understand. And he said, I want you to be in covenant with your wife like that.
Amen.
Yes, Lord. I'll love her. And where I'll go, she'll go. And marriage is hard. Paul said it in Corinthians. Marriage is hard. But I love my wife.
Amen.
Now I'm talking about something I did. I'm married almost 28 years. I'm going back 20 years. But when I met him, son, when I met him, that man that bartended for 3 years, that was doing drugs, that was running around and doing all that stuff, that man died a long time ago.
Amen.
I don't even go by Robbie anymore. I go by my middle name, Joseph.
Yes.
I go by Joseph. Because that man is dead.
Yes.
You know the government owns you? Your social security number when you was born. Yeah, I'll mess with your theology a little bit.
That's all right, go ahead.
Do you know that when a ship comes into dock, it's a berth. Comes from the water and it berths at a dock and it gets a birth certificate at the dock from the manifesto that it's been birthed at the dock. So when you're born, you know it's illegal to have a baby not in a hospital. Or if you have a baby, you have to go to the hospital. You know that, right? So that's why from anything that is born of water falls under not the law of the land, but the law of the sea.
Maritime
law. So that when you go to the hospital, the doc got his doctor's name from the dock where the ship came in. And that's why when you give birth through the water, your baby receives a birth certificate from the doctor.
Wow.
Pretty crazy. And you know money is liquidity, right? When it breaks down, it's like water, right? And watch this. And the bank runs the liquidity. It controls the flow of the assets of money. And money is water, liquid, liquidity. And that's why a bank on either side of a canal controls the flow of where the money goes.
Yeah.
So when you was born, you received a birth certificate from the dock saying that the government owns you. Well, look at me. You don't own me. You don't own me. Because that man that was given birth in Mercy Hospital at about 5:30 in the morning, where I received my birth certificate from a doc, well, he died.
Yes.
So the government has no control over me.
Amen.
You don't own me no more. In fact, I died. That man that you owned, he died. And I've been born again.
Amen.
Under the lion of the tribe of Judah. And he now owns my birth certificate.
Amen.
Amen.
So, do with me what you will.
Yes.
If it's the FEMA camp to try to re-educate me, well, I've already been re-educated.
Yes.
There is no re-educating me.
Amen.
I love Jesus. I love Jesus. I serve him. He is my master.
Yes.
I was born from the blood of Yeshua.
Yes.
Born again. And Satan, the rulers and the powers of this world,
yes,
you own nothing on me.
Amen.
Nothing.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
That's good stuff.
Hallelujah.
It goes on YouTube. That's why I was talking into the camera. You know, he's the prince of the power of the air. I wanted him,
yes,
to know.
Amen.
So, the glory.
Hey.
Glory is the power. It represents the power, the reputation, the importance of someone, of the heart, soul, intelligence of a person, right? The power and reputation and importance of someone, of the heart, the soul, the intelligence, and the intelligence of that person. The glory of God. And I'm going to end with this. I got one more scripture. The glory of God is the manifestation of his divine attributes. And that means it could be manifested in a visible light. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. When you walk in someone's presence, you're a light. You received it tonight.
Yes.
You received it. You are a light.
Yes.
Be a light.
Yes.
A manifestation of his essential character and qualities. Be like Jesus. Don't judge no one. Love them.
Amen.
Help them.
Yes.
If they've done something wrong, go to them in love and try to restore them. Not judge them.
Yes.
Jesus didn't do that. And if you're doing that, something wrong. You ain't being like Jesus.
Amen.
In the Old Covenant, 25 words used for the glory. And the main word is the word kabod. It means to be weighty with importance. And I actually did a breakdown on this word, kabod, both in the Hebrew and in the Greek. And but she's got it plain. If you're really hungry for Jesus and you really want more Jesus, you know, Wednesday nights, Charlene goes out of her way to prepare stuff that she gets really good. I mean,
man.
If you're thinking it's not good, you need to check yourself.
Yes, sir.
Because she's given stuff that's weighty. And it says in the Old Covenant, 25 words used for glory, the main word is kabod. It means weighty with importance. What I'm telling you is important.
Yeah.
It's heavy in richness. Man, I'll tell you things God showed me. That's right. I'll tell you things that God showed me you've never heard before. And man, people hear it, they're like, wow! Because that's weighty. It's like, wow. It's like, you know, it doesn't mean I'm special. No, he just showed me something. And it ain't for me, it's to give.
Yeah.
You know?
It's steak instead of skim milk.
Right.
Yeah. Amen.
It's heavy in power, Isaiah 8:7. It's heavy in reputation. And all I'm here to talk about is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I want to show you something. Go to John chapter 1. I've got this scripture and one more and we're done. John chapter 1. John chapter 1. Listen to this. It all goes back down. It says, listen to this. It says, and in the beginning, this is John, the beloved of Jesus. He's going to manifest who Jesus is. That's what he's going to do. He says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Wow. Now, I know some Bibles that have kicked that out, you know, remove the deity of Jesus Christ, but you're not going to. The same was in the beginning with God. That word beginning is Bereshit, which is Genesis. It's Genesis he's talking about right there. Right? All things were made by him. That's Jesus. And without him was not anything made that was made. You can see that in Colossians as well. In him was life. And the life was in the light of men. Jesus said he was the light. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended the night. John is making a connection with Genesis when the light came in, when he was creating the world. He's letting us know that Jesus was the one, the light that came into darkness that created everything. Yes. And now that light is coming to man, and man didn't comprehend it because you and I are one with the earth. 70% water, 30% flesh. You, 70% water, 30% flesh. The earth had to be baptized, you must be baptized. I mean, come on, let's really just... He's plain.
Yes.
Let's go. Let's keep going. Watch this. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. Now John prepared the way. This is the old covenant. He fell under the old covenant. His father was Zechariah, who they slew between the altar and the holy place. The same came for a witness. The old covenant bears witness to who Jesus is. He said that. He said, my father beareth witness of me. What is that? That's the 39 books of the old covenant. Go look for them. They bear witness of Jesus. They bear witness of Jesus.
Yes.
Not of Muhammad, not of Buddha, not of Islam, not of yoga, not of the Hinduist God destroyer, not of the Antichrist, though it makes plain what the Antichrist will look like. He will try to look like Jesus.
Yes.
The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light. The old covenant, John in representation, John points out there's the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world, and all that all men through him might believe. He was not that light. John wasn't the light, because the old covenant was in darkness, it was concealed, right? But he was sent to bear witness of the light. You know, John had cut his head off, right? That's symbolically, his head was separated from his body, and that's Jesus. He was separated from heaven to earth. He was separated from God. Yeah, that's what's going on. He took upon the weight of the sins of the world. My God, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? Why have thou forsaken me? The sins of the world was placed on him. He felt a decapitation for the first time in his life from the Father because the sin was on him. It says in verse 9, that was the true light, which lighteth every man that comes into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God. He opened their synesis. That's what he's talking. He gave them power to become the sons of God. The two disciples that was walking on the road of Emmaus, of Emmaus, when Jesus had arose from the dead, they didn't know who he was. They didn't recognize his face. He was talking to them. Haven't you heard about our Messiah that had died? And it says, and he opened their understanding. That word understanding is the Greek word synesis, through Moses and the prophets, of who he was and what he must go through. You want your synesis opened up? Your synesis? A synesis is a little river. And synesis means when a bunch of little rivers hit a big old river. And that's like, wow! You got it then. Ain't no little trickle anymore, baby. I'm talking about a mighty river. That's what Jesus said. The Word of God is a mighty river. In fact, four rivers flowed out of Eden, and they all point to Jesus Christ.
Flowing revelations.
We're almost done. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Here we go. We just went to Moses in the tabernacle, right? Check this out. Let's look at that real quick. In verse 14, it says, the word was made flesh and dwelt. In the Greek, that word is skinu. That's the same word for tabernacle. Moses built the tabernacle, and that tabernacle was Jesus. That's why John is saying, and the word became a tabernacle, and the word was made flesh and dwelt. The word dwelt in the Greek, it's the word skinu, to live in, to dwell, to spread a tent. It's taken from the Hebrew skin, 46:33, which means tabernacle, tent, shelter, or dwelling place, a tabernacle. So John now is connecting the dots. The tabernacle that Moses had in the beginning, that was carried around, that he wrote about, it was him.
Yes.
It's him.
Yes.
And he don't stop there. Go to 1 John. 1 John 1. I'm done. Last scripture. Make plain. Make simple. What am I preaching today? Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Jesus Christ, the very express image and likeness of God the Father. What am I talking about today? I'm showing you His glory. You want to see the glory of God? You want to see the glory of God? Son, it is on fire today.
Amen.
Because the Word of God in Hebrews chapter 10 is a consuming fire, son. It says in Jeremiah that He comes like a hammer and a fire. Fire. Ooh. But I'm talking about the Jesus fire, son. I'm not talking about that phony fake fire.
Amen.
I'm not talking about the imitation fire.
Amen.
I'm talking about the fire that if you get in, you're going to get burnt.
Yes.
Up.
Amen.
Crispy. And you're going to need a new body. Because that's what I needed. I got blobs on. I'm burned up. I've been amongst the fiery stones. Not up there, but right down here in His face. And son, He just starts revealing a little bit, and I'm screaming, wait! You're burning me up! I can't handle it! Man, how awesome! You know, when we see, like John had come out and said, man, sing that song. Man, you know, what was the name of the song again?
I can only imagine.
Man, when we before Him. Golly! Man, can you imagine? Man, what it'll be like when we walk? Man. 1 John. 1 John chapter 1, verse 10. Verse 1 through 10. I like to give a little bit of the word when I read, but so I don't want to just give you a little scripture. I want you to know the context.
That's right.
Because He is, I mean, wow. I would rather give you His explanation than mine.
Yes. Amen.
Let Him explain what it is.
Right.
Him meaning God, Yahweh.
Yeah.
John writes, you know, here he is. He starts in the beginning. He says, that which was from Genesis, that word beginning right there in 1 John is Genesis. That which was from Bereshit in the beginning, from Genesis, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. Listen to what he's saying. That which was from the beginning, which we had heard about a tabernacle, about this, about all of those things up there. He's saying now, back then, it was a skin tent. It was a tabernacle. And it was pointing to Jesus. He says, now, he's saying, watch, that which was from the beginning, which we heard, the beginning was Genesis, which we have seen now with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled the word of life. Man, they got their arms wrapped around Him. They're looking at Him face to face. They went 3.5 years. He's saying, For the life was manifested, for the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and we bear witness and show unto you that eternal life, which was from the Father and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, we declare it unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write, we unto you, that your joy may be full.
Lord.
That you may be full of joy. This then is the message which we have heard of him. What message did they hear from him? He's going to tell you now. And this message is in the beginning. We have heard of him. This then is the message which we have heard of him. And we declare it unto you. That's what I'm doing. Declaring it unto you. That God is light. Wow. And in him there is no darkness at all. No shadow when he turns. The old covenant was the shadow. Now the light has come.
Yeah.
Where the old covenant is shadowed and covered and vaguely seeing. And now, man, we're looking at him.
Amen.
Jesus, it's you!
Amen.
Yeah, it's me. Wait till I lose this skin, then you're going to see something different. He took that skin off, and then they saw the face of God, son. That's why they didn't recognize him. Then he looked like Adam in the beginning. Woo-woo. We get crazy now. If we say that we have fellowship with him, and we walk in darkness, we lie.
Lie.
Don't lie to yourself. And do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us, I don't care what sin it is, from, what's that word right there?
All
sin. All sin.
Hallelujah.
All sin. Now there is one on pardonable sin, and we know it's the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit, to call the works of the Holy Spirit the works of Satan. That's blaspheming him. But he cleanses us from all sin. Go to the next one. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, that's what I had to do. You see, the Bible says, confess ye one to another that your sins may be forgiven.
Amen.
That's why, hey, I don't have a problem. I'm not going to get into a whole rant and rave what I did in my bad days.
Amen.
I'm not going to give glory to that.
Amen.
I'm going to give glory and honor to the one who set me free from that.
Amen.
And talk about him 99.9% of the time.
Amen.
And just let you know that I was a dirty, filthy rag that needed a Savior, and I was saved.
Yes.
I've had people leave the church because of some of the things that I said that I've done in the past. But you know what? That's okay.
Yeah.
It's okay. Because they still see me as the old man and not the new. So they have an eyesight problem.
Yeah.
And the eyes will open through the tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll find out if you're eating that tree, well, then you're going to be passing judgment on people.
That's right.
And Jesus said, what he told Nicodemus? Nicodemus was in a sycamore tree. That sycamore tree is a fig tree. Go look it up in the Greek. It's an inferior fig tree. Look at it. That's what it says in the Hebrew. A fig tree. Nicodemus, he wanted to see Jesus. What did he do? He got in a fig tree. The fig tree is the knowledge of good and evil. The knowledge of good and evil is where it shows us Jesus.
Amen.
But when he saw Jesus, what did Jesus tell Nicodemus? Come out of that tree. Come out of that tree, Nicodemus, because I'm coming to your house tonight.
Amen.
He met Jesus. But the only way he could see Jesus was he had to climb up into the old covenant. He had to climb up into the old covenant. He had to climb up in a fig tree. He wanted to see Jesus. That's what I want. I want to see Jesus. Because all the fig tree will do is show you Jesus. But it's going to show you, it's going to open your eyes to other things. But if you're using it to look at other things, like the Pharisees and Sadducees were doing, Jesus said, you search the scriptures and in them you think you have life, the old covenant, but there they would speak of me. Stop looking in it to judge other people.
Yes, right.
Stop looking at word I, open their eyes. It says that word right there, it means as to looking down the barrel of a gun.
Yes.
Do you know that? When Eve's eyes were open, it was as to looking down the barrel of a gun.
Mm-hmm.
To do what? No, that gun was never made to be used. It wasn't never supposed to be used. Nicodemus, come out the tree. I'm coming to your house. Lord, he received salvation. I gave half of what I own to the poor. And I gave him double back and gave him this back and gave him this back. Truly, salvation has come to the house of Nicodemus. Zacchaeus. Thank you very much. Zacchaeus was a little old man. A little old man was he. He climbed up on a sycamore tree. It's actually a fig tree. Look it up. To see what he could see.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah.
How's it, how was the rest of it? What's that? He climbed up in a sycamore tree to see what he could see.
For the Lord he wanted to see.
And Jesus said, Zacchaeus, come out of that tree. For I'm coming to your house today. For I'm coming to your house. That's what you need. You need Jesus to come to your house.
Amen.
If Jesus comes to your house,
amen.
Now you just empty your pockets. You just want to bless people.
Amen.
He didn't go run to the temple.
That's right.
He didn't go run to the temple. Truly, salvation come to the house.
Amen.
If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
Father, we confess our sins to you today.
Amen.
And Lord, we need to be cleansed. And your word says, Father, you cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
Verse 10, last verse. If we say that we have not sinned, is another verse. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Is that it? That's 10, right? That's it. Guess what? So if you say you have no sin, or if you say that you have not sinned, will you make him a liar and the word is not in you? So if you can confess your sin, you know that you're a sinner and you need a Savior.
Amen.
Well, guess what? Salvation has come to your house.
Yes.
Father, in Jesus' name,
yes, Lord.
Lord, your glory is what it's all about.
Yes.
Your glory. Father, we've come face to face with you today by going to your word.
Yes.
You are the face bread.
Yes.
You are the bread that gives us life. And Father, we thank you. Cleanse us, Father, from all unrighteousness. Restore us, renew us,
yes.
And use us for your glory and honor.
Amen.
In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. And amen.